Hi everyone, Simon Camilleri here. I'm with Andy May, who's my assistant pastor at Bundura Presbyterian Church. And we've been doing, we've been sort of a double act a little bit over the years with the carols events.
Oh, hey Simon.
Oh, hey Andy. I know if you can help me, but I'm looking for the meaning of Christmas.
And tonight the theme is Christmas Unwrapped, so I was wondering, what are you hoping for? What are you hoping to unwrap? What are you hoping to receive this Christmas?
There it is, just underneath the J. You can see it. There it says.
So this Christmas, don't make your own light. Turn to Jesus, believe him, and find the true light of the world.
I've seen sort of the creative director for a few years putting on, working out the theme and working out how it might integrate into the service. And you've been, we'll talk about the various roles that you've taken, but the main, one of the main, most important things you've done is be the one where the gospel, you share the gospel in a more direct way, do the gospel talk. And so I thought we could just talk about your experience over the years with doing that. I've got a bunch of questions. And yeah, we just really want to mine your experience, especially for ministers who have are planning to use the Carols Pack this year and want to share the gospel, might be preparing the talk for that. They may have that specific role in the service. So, cool. Do you want to... my first question, Annie, to allow you to talk, is how many years have you done the gospel talk at Bundy Carols, as we call it, Bundura Presbyterian Carols?
I think we've been working together probably just about on 10 years, but I was doing the talks probably a few years even before that for our carols. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, cool. And how do you prepare for these sort of talks?
I think there's a few key things. So one of the things is to pray, because ultimately it's God's work to draw people to himself. But I think as the years have gone on, like a key thing has been working with you, Simon, in terms of the creative director, working with the theme and how all the elements of the evening work together. I think that's key. And the other one is choosing a passage, choosing the different passages that will be read, but choosing that passage that I'll be speaking on for the night.
Okay, cool. Yeah, we'll talk a bit later about how, whether it's a Bible talk or whether it's a thematic talk or something. But one of the initial questions I wanted to ask is, what particular opportunity do you think Christmas gives the church to share the gospel?
I think we have such incredible theological realities that we can share, like the incarnation, the fact that God becomes flesh, God with us in Jesus, is such a huge thing to share with people. But we still have this great opportunity in our culture to do that with traditions, with things that people are used to at Christmas that work with that. For example, gifts, giving gifts, a time where people long for peace and joy and hope. Like, these are in fact Christian gifts from God that we can still use in our culture to share. That the fact that people still sing carols at community events in parks are things which actually give us the opportunity to share the wonder of the gospel of Jesus with us.
Yeah, I've always thought it amazing that as our culture in Australia becomes, in certain elements, more hostile to Christianity, at Christmas you can still have blatantly Christian lyrics being sung in Christmas carols at our carols by candlelight and all those sort of events.
Which is still amazing in my mind, that people can sing of God become flesh and God coming to deal with the problem of our sin, and people singing that freely on TV, at carols, or in communities everywhere around Melbourne.
Yeah, it obviously doesn't mean anything if people don't grapple with the realities of those words, but it gives Christians an opportunity to use that door in to share the gospel.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, well, what particular... So thinking of that minister or that children's worker or just that person in the congregation who's been given the task to do the gospel talk at the Christmas carols or the carols event or community carols event, what particular challenges do you think they face in doing that?
Well, I think firstly, we have to be faithful to God's word. I think any time we want to share the gospel from God's word, we have to be faithful. The group that we're speaking to, the congregational audience, the people hearing us, will end up being a mixed group. So all ages, that's one of the challenges. So in other words, probably a short attention span and all kinds of backgrounds. So you're talking about people who might be familiar with Christmas. You might be talking about people from overseas or other cultures who are unfamiliar with the message of Christmas, and you'll have a Christian audience as well as people who are not Christian. So it has all that challenge associated with it.
Yeah, cool. with that challenge, with all those different factors, what elements do you try to incorporate every year in a gospel talk for Bundy Carols?
I think what I want to incorporate is a passage, a short passage, being faithful to that text. Because I think it needs to be short and engaging, I also think about how people are hearing that. I think a visual element of some sort can help people, can help focus visually on an idea from that passage, but also keep people's attention span. I think it needs to be filled with prayer, so I think we need to actually pray about it. And I think we're trying to think about how this works in a whole program of our church in trying to build connections with people. So how it fits in with our whole approach to sharing Christ with people.
Yeah, well, that's one of the questions I haven't got in here, but that sort of bounces off that idea, is do you think of this as like a missile where you drop it into people's lives and hope it has a big impact for the person that may have never come to church? Or do you think it as a point of connection that may interweave people into our church community and, and I guess in the fact that we have carols in our church is different to the sort of person, sort of church that would run a big carols event out in a park. They would probably maybe understand that they wouldn't be able to see some of those people again. How do you think about it?
I think if you think about it like a bridge, we're trying to build opportunities where we can have relationship, like a bridge with people, so that we can continue to keep sharing the gospel of Jesus with people. So for a lot of people who come to carols, they might never have come into a church building before. So that's one thing that they leave with a different idea perhaps that they've ever had about church. That's one opportunity. So we're looking at how we can actually have other opportunities to share with them about Jesus. So we have a Christmas service every year where we can share about Jesus. And a few weeks after, we actually have a kids' holiday program in summer. And very much we think about the carols linked with these things
so
that people can keep coming and keep meeting us and keep hearing more things about Jesus.
Yep. Do you know of people who have connected to the church purely because of carols?
Yeah, absolutely. Things like carols, which are extremely friendly for someone who has never been inside a church before, to things like we run a dinner every winter. So we've had people who've come to both those things for years before actually coming to anything else, but eventually they've actually come along to our services, our Bible study groups, and eventually have actually come to know Jesus personally. So that's how we see carols fitting into a whole program.
Yeah, cool. So I guess that takes a bit of some of the pressure off, not feeling like you have to do everything in this talk.
Yep.
I think that's one of the questions here. I'll jump to that question. The gospel's full of big theological ideas, yep. right? If you wanted to sit down and someone said, please explain the gospel in full to me, you could have a really long, yep. you could talk all day, right?
Yep.
Yet with these talks, how long do you try and keep it to approximately?
I try and aim for about 5 minutes.
Yeah, so that's yep. that's a struggle for the for the preacher who's used to a 45-minute sermon or something.
Yeah.
So what you can't tell everything in that 5 minutes. How do you navigate that when you've only got a short time? How much of the gospel do you feel you need to tell? Do you feel if you don't say some things you haven't told the gospel? How do you navigate that?
When I choose a passage, I'd want to be faithful to that passage. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if I was looking at Luke chapter 2, talking about Christ the Saviour is born, he is the Messiah, he is the Lord, I might choose one of those ideas to really major on and mm-hmm. share on. That would be the same with the Matthew 1 passage, where it talks about God giving this baby the name Jesus, mm-hmm. the Lord saves, because he will save people from their sins. It could be John 1, where it talks about Jesus being the light of the world. So I'll try and be faithful to the passage and perhaps take one big idea
mm.
and maybe explain that and the things around that. But I won't necessarily explain all the elements of the gospel because it's such a short amount of time. The other thing that helps me is thinking about, say, in Acts, the Apostle Paul speaks to different people in different contexts. So in Acts 13, he's at a synagogue in Pisidian Antioch, and he goes to the Old Testament. He talks about Saul, he talks about Moses, he talks mm-hmm. about the law, and he talks about Jesus in that context. But then when Paul's in Athens in Acts 17, mm-hmm. and he's in the Areopagus, clearly he's talking about Jesus, but he doesn't even mention Jesus' name. And he'll refer to something their poets or philosophers yeah. wrote. So he's actually yeah. speaking to a different context, and he's speaking about different things, mm. but they're still about Jesus.
Yeah.
So I think that's the challenge before us, thinking about the context we're speaking in. So a carol's event here is not a Sunday church service, but neither is it a community park carols.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to think about the context and then speaking God's word faithfully to this context.
Yep. What would you say if you heard a Christmas talk and it didn't mention blank, you'd say that you didn't mention the gospel. What would be that blank? That if you don't mention that, you haven't really mentioned the gospel.
If I'm thinking about Christmas and I'm thinking about the heart of our Christian faith, it's Jesus. So, yeah. and that's the goal. I want to leave people asking why Jesus? Why did God send Jesus? That's the wonder mm. of Christmas. So if I went to a carol's event and in no way did it mention Jesus and it was run by Christians, I would be left feeling a bit disappointed, a bit yeah. disheartened. Why wasn't Jesus mentioned? Because he is the heart of Christmas.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you've been doing it for a while. We said about 10 years. And each year we try different things. And I've always had the philosophy of it can fail this year because we can try something new next year. So I've always had sort of big ambitions for what we could try each year. What are the things that you've learned as the person doing the gospel talk? How have you improved, I guess, over the years in doing that? What have you learned?
I think what I've learned is less is more.
Mm-hmm.
So rather than, say, trying to do a 15 or 20-minute talk, I think I'd rather leave people hearing one or two things clearly
mm.
and wanting more and coming back to hear more. I think I've learned that the various elements of the evening can work together better.
Yep.
I think early on, when I did carols, we had very different elements and often engaging. Like one year we did a Gangnam Christmas-style dance, which people still remember to this day. But did it fit in, like, in the flow of the elements? Not really. Like, it stood alone quite well.
Yeah.
But how did it fit in the theme? We're not quite sure. But I think we've gotten a whole lot better than at that. And I think that for a big reason has been working for me closely with you as the creative director to make sure the elements are all actually helping with what we're trying to do with the whole evening. I think I've learnt to about who comes to the carol. So the idea that we're not a community carols, we're not a Sunday church service, but something in between, I think has helped me a lot to know exactly where to pitch the talk.
Yeah, I guess that's good. And different churches will be doing different types of events, so it's worth them. Yeah, if it's a big community carols out in the local park with 5,000 people, don't think of it like a church service.
Yeah.
And yeah, know your context. Okay, I think we've covered those. Now, some sermons are focused on a Bible passage, and some are topical. What would you've talked about the importance of having a passage, but you've also talked about having an idea that you're trying to communicate and simplifying that. What do you think of this talk? Do you think of it as a Bible talk? Do you think of it as a topical talk that uses an appropriate Bible passage, or how do you think of it?
I think I start with the passage, but if we were just focusing on explaining a passage, I might do more things like explain the context of that passage and then refer to other passages to help us also understand some of the things that are coming from that one passage. But you just don't have the time to do that. So in a short 5-minute talk, I'd start with a passage, take an idea, and then try and talk about that and engage with that without necessarily explaining all the bits of that passage. So, for example, one year our theme was rescue. So Jesus is a saviour. So if we looked at a passage like that Matthew 1 passage, we might talk about what it means for Jesus to save us from our sins, but I don't have a whole lot of time to explain all the elements as to why like God made us, that he's our judge, he has every right to do that. I just don't have the time to explain all those elements, but I'll explain the one main idea and try and be faithful to that.
Yeah, and I think that then guides the rest of the service as the person who's sort of creative directing. Is I can think about what things we can use musically, what things we can use decoration-wise, what skits. I've done magic tricks up on the stage, but all of that is actually pointing people towards that idea. Helping, prepping people to think about that idea and preparing people to hear the gospel at the end, so it doesn't come across as just, we've had all this fun and now there's the gospel talk, the obligatory gospel talk.
Yep.
It all fits together. It all sort of blends together well. So,
and that's been a key thing, is actually the whole night, like thinking about the whole evening telling a story and how the different acts in the evening and how the songs fit in with those different movements actually reinforce the gospel. So that has been a big element of what's developed over the years.
Yeah, great. So what are, talking about some of those extra creative elements, what are some of the creative things you've used to share the gospel in your time? We could talk about the things that we've had during the whole service, but you've often thought about something creative and something visual. What are some of the ones that you've used and that you keep coming back to too?
I mean, I think Christmas is such a visual time of year. We have decorations on trees, we have lights, Our culture is used to that. So I think it helps us, in fact, if we engage with that. So over the years, I've used various elements in my talk. I've often used babies, newborn babies in our church, because it is still an amazing thing that God became flesh. Like, you could say at one point in history, you could actually meet God in the flesh, Emmanuel, God with us. It's a wonder. And when you have a newborn baby and you actually think God came as a baby, it is staggering.
God with us. That when we see the baby Jesus, we see the Son of God, all of God's power and all of God's glory in a surprising little package in this little baby boy Jesus. Shall I put him in the manger?
I think I've used other elements, like we've used the theme of Jesus being the light of the world. And so we've used things like candles that light up. I've used a large ball that lit up that represented Jesus and how we actually draw light from him. And I used that candle and lit that candle near the large globe. I've used a rope that has been cut, and this is a cut and restore magic trick to talk about how God actually reconciles us to himself, as though the rope had never been cut. Yeah, we've used large gift boxes. We've used mangers, you know, actually on the stage. So we've used a lot of visual elements because I think it helps engagement, but it also helps communicate a big theological idea. Simply.
That's the challenge, is using creative things not just for entertainment. And I don't think we very rarely do anything just for entertainment. It always serves the gospel thread that we're trying to communicate. And that I don't think we find that restrictive at all. We never like go, oh, we'd love to do a juggling act, and how are we going to put that in there? As we discuss it, we think about what things will this particular theme, this particular passage, this way of presenting the gospel, what can we do to help communicate that? And that gives us at least a direction, which is really useful. How can... Oh, yeah, we've talked a bit about how the rest of the event prepares people for hearing and connecting with the talk you're preparing. Any more thoughts on that? Or
I think one of the things sometimes we preachers think is it's all up to us. We think that because we're tasked with explaining the Bible, then it all rests on our shoulders. And I think one of the things that I've learned is actually to say, no, that's not true. It actually rests on God. God is the one who works powerfully through his word, through his spirit to draw people, but also he works through his church. I am one part of a whole team of people at our Carols event, you know, from people who barbecue outside, from people who welcome people and who've decorated the sets, who do the face painting afterwards and who serve food afterwards, from people who are doing music and creative elements. Everyone, in fact, is working towards the same goal, and I'm part of that team. And when we're working together, I think it leaves people coming with that experience, wow, knowing Jesus is great. And that's the thing. That's the thing we're aiming for. Knowing Jesus is great, and that's the reason why all these people are doing this. They know Jesus. And I want to know who they know. That's really what we're trying to do. And I think that's how I see what I'm doing fitting in with that whole team.
Yeah, great. Now, we made a call a few years ago when we were thinking about that element of where does the sermon or the gospel talk fit in with the rest of other things. And it was to make you, as the gospel preacher, the MC. Now, many lots of churches won't have that ability to do that, or they won't have a preacher who can be an MC, or they won't, or they have a great MC. But at least talk about why we decided to do that, because it may be an idea for other churches, or at least the reasons why may help them.
I think why we did that is if we are actually building a relationship with people, because ultimately that's what we're trying to do, a connection. The MC is largely the one holding the various elements together through the flow of the night. And they're the ones who have begun building that relationship with people. And I think one of the reasons why we did that is when someone comes to give the talk then, it's like they've already familiar with the people who you're building the relationship with. It was that trying to avoid that gear shift. Now, it's not impossible, but still that gear shift when you bring someone new into the evening. And people who come to our carols may actually not know that person, may not know that that person, for example, is a pastor at the church.
Yep.
They may just be someone who's different.
Yeah. So are they thinking, why should I listen to this person?
Who is this person?
I've
not met them yet after, say, 45 minutes.
Yep.
But by actually making one of the pastors the MC, it helps to build that connection so it doesn't seem like a gear shift to have someone share then from the Bible.
Yep. So I guess if you can't have the preacher also be the MC, maybe incorporate them or introduce them some other point.
Yes.
So that it's a sort of a friendly face when it gets up to share the gospel.
And that would be something good to do at some point, either earlier or...
Even if they just do the announcements.
That's right.
Or anything, that would be,
Or even at the start, a welcome to the church, so that they're at least introduced to the people who are there.
Yeah, that's smart. Yep. and lastly, once it's all over, how do you judge a successful, I love that word, successful, because the word successful is good, because then you judge what does it mean to have, give a successful talk, and some people will look at the response or how people talk about it afterwards or whether you nailed certain bits or what. How do you define success in this particular role?
I think it's a big question. I mean, ultimately, I think we want to be successful in God's eyes. You know, have we been faithful in the evening to various things? Have I been faithful to God's word? Have we worked together well as a team? I actually think God's really concerned about how we have worked together. So often there is a sense that at the end of the evening, we just feel this sense of relief and thankfulness that we've had this opportunity to share. But in terms of those other things, we don't want to become sort of too worldly in the eyes of success, that we had lots and lots of people come. But there is a sense in which we are really encouraged that lots of people have heard something of Christ, something of the gospel. So we want to actually rejoice that God brought lots of people. I think it's great when we see people coming back, whether they come back the next year or whether they come to something else like the Christmas service or the holiday program or our Sunday services. We are really thankful for that God has given us these opportunities to keep sharing something more about Jesus. So in that sense too, I think it's a success when we keep getting people opportunities to hear the gospel.
Great. Well, and maybe as a final encouragement for ministers who are particularly tackling this year, so this is part of the carols pack incorporating When Santa Learned the Gospel into the service, and the theme being Christmas for the Naughty and Nice. I guess we are, people could be watching this at any time, so we're now in the end of September. So you've got a couple, you know, 2-3 months away, Christmas is. How are you thinking now about, or what are you looking forward to in terms of sharing the gospel with this theme of Naughty and Nice?
I think what I like about the theme, what I like about the book, and what we do, I think, year to year, is we take something about Christmas that people expect and we can turn it on its head, because the gospel turns things on its head. And what I like about this theme is the notion that God is a God of grace. He doesn't give you what you deserve. I think that's an amazing aspect of the gospel. And again, something we shouldn't lose the wonder of. Mm-hmm. So in the months leading up, I'm thinking about Bible passages that share something of that. Bible passages that speak of the wonder of God's grace, not our works. So as I reflect on passages like Ephesians 2, as I look at the gospel accounts again in Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, I'm looking for those elements where the wonder of God's grace is evident. In the months leading up, I'm talking with Simon about the creative elements of the night. I'm looking at the passages and how they fit in with the flow of that. And then what I hope is that I will settle on one or two passages and then start to think about how we might share that, or how I might share that in the context of the whole evening. Thinking about the songs, where the songs fit in, the carols fit into that theme. And then once we've sort of figured out that outline for the evening, is then really working on my talk and memorizing it. I think that's a big element too, is doing it from memory, so I'm not looking at notes, so that I'm engaging people with the amazing wonder of a God who is gracious to us and doesn't treat us as we deserve, but gives us this gift of the gospel of Christ and forgiveness in him.
Oh, I guess that's the other benefit of having a short talk.
Yes.
Very cool. Well, thank you very much for sharing that. And if people have questions, please put it in the comments on this video, and we'll throw around the ideas. And we really hope that it's a that any pastor or minister or person in the congregation that's working on the gospel, that this has been interesting. And yeah, we'll be praying for you, and we look forward to seeing how God uses you to share the gospel in your context. So thanks.
Oh, it's finally finished. 14 hours straight of me climbing ladders, dangling off roofs, and laying cables on the front lawn. You probably can't see, but there's 20,000 bulbs on this house now. You know, I've had no sleep. I've gained a few grey hairs in my credit card. Don't even ask me about my credit card. But it's amazing. I haven't put the power on, so it's probably a bit dark and hard to see, but up I've got here is a, when I plug this in, I've got this inflatable Frosty the Snowman will come up. It's amazing. Yeah. On the roof I've got a machine that'll shoot fake snow across the whole neighbourhood. Yes, along the path, I've got holographic reindeer that leap up and down. They were the only things left on the shelf, really. And I don't think I've forgotten the true reason for the season. Now, around the side, I've got a beautiful, antique, life-size, handcrafted nativity set. And when you press a button, the little animatronic Jesus pops up and waves. And while they play It's a Small World After All, it's going to put his house to shame, that's for sure. But do you want to see it all?
Yeah!
Oh, fantastic, okay. I'll show you. Here you go. This is the one last piece here. Don't worry, it's very, very safe. Very safe, I think. It's all pretty much in place. Very good. Well, this is going to be
the best lighting display you have ever seen. And everyone will know that my house has brought the light of Christmas to Bundy Boulevard. Can we get a countdown from 10? No. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Here we go.
Simon was trying so hard. He was trying so hard to make Christmas special. He was trying to keep up with his neighbor. He was trying to make his own light for Christmas, and he's ended up making everything darkness, hasn't he? I don't know about you, but I can relate to Simon because I find myself running around trying really hard to make life special and meaningful, only to find that sometimes I'm disappointed by myself, disappointed by others. And you know, that can happen even at Christmas time, can't it? But even more importantly, you know, sometimes we try and make life really special and meaningful without God. We leave God out of the picture. And the Bible says that that's living in darkness. Now, to live in the darkness without God means not being able to see properly how to live properly God's way. And the Bible says that when we don't live God's way, that's called sin. And that's a problem that affects all of us. And the Bible says that to live in the darkness without God, well, ultimately it means death. Because God is the source of life. And without God, there's no life. And that's a problem that affects each of us. We need light, don't we? Do you reckon we need light? But we can't make our own light. We actually need God's light. We need God's light, don't we? John chapter 1, verse 4 says, "In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Well, who's that light? That light is God's own Son, Jesus, and here he comes now. That baby, born so many years ago, is God's light. That baby that the wise men came to worship, that baby is God's light. That baby grew up to be a man who always lived God's way. He's the light. That baby grew up to be a man who died on the cross for our sins. He died our death so that we could live forever. That baby is God's true light sent into the world for us. The true light that shines in the darkness of our lives. The true light that overcomes the darkness of our lives. John chapter 1 verse 9 says that the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And the good news is, this Christmas, is that the true light is here. We don't have to make our own light because he's here. And the good news of Christmas is that when we turn to trust in Jesus, when we believe his words, we also become children of God, children who belong to the light. So this Christmas, don't make your own light. Turn to Jesus, believe him, and find the true light of the world.